Thank you, Mikael, for that kind introduction. So first of all, I would like to make some advertisements for my group, which just started up at ETH Zurich earlier this year in January. So far it's myself and 4.5 PhD students. Here you can see a typical excursion, group excursion in Switzerland. And here you can see the bloated group photo where you try to gather everyone, all the students that you can find. So having said that, none of what I will be presenting today will be from my own group. It will be from my postdoc time in the group of Alana Spergusic at the University of Toronto and collaborators there and at Stanford and funded by the Swedish Research Council. So we've heard today from Rocío about generative models, or what we can also call inverse design models, which are models which allow us to search the chemical space to find functional molecules with targeted properties. So these are very useful, but usually they rely on what we can call property predictors, or what Rocío called surrogate models. So here I show two examples for inverse design methods for chemical reactivity or catalysis. So on the left-hand side, we have a genetic algorithm. On the right-hand side, we have a more modern deep learning method called a variational autoencoder. And key to both of these approaches is that you have something called a property predictor, which tells you how good is this molecule for a specific purpose. So we have different flavors of property predictors. We have pure machine learning, so this is very fast, and it can be accurate for what we can call interpolation, so structures which are quite similar to what is seen in the training set. Unfortunately, this is very bad for inverse design, because usually your target is to go outside what you already know and what you have in the training set. We can also do physics-based simulation, so that is what many people in this room are familiar with, so we can do DFT, we can do couple of cluster, we can even make Roland happy, we can do CASPT2, but usually this is too slow for using in these inverse design methods. And as we all know, it's not always that these simulations are accurate against experiment. We can have complications such as solvation and other things. So what is, let's say, emerging in this field at the moment is what we can call hybrid models, so that we already saw some examples of this in the talks, and I think we will see more throughout the rest of the conference. So these are models where you try to combine the best of both worlds. So you try to use your, say, physical or your chemical insight and the models that we've developed over many, many years and create a bit smarter machine learning architectures. The problem at this moment right now is that we're in the phase of actually developing these methods, so we cannot use them at the moment in these inverse design applications. So what I will be talking about today is not, let's say, full-fledged hybrid models, but what we can call hybrid light models. So these have actually been known for a very long time, so we call them by the name semi-empirical methods. And I will give four brief examples of how we have developed and used this semi-empirical method for different molecular design objectives. So the first thing that I want to talk about is reactive force fields for reactant optimization. So here we take a quite old idea by Frank Jensen from the early 90s, which is called the SEAM method. So in the SEAM method, we take two force fields, so it's a classical method, and then we take a transition state of a reaction as the intersection between the reactant force field and the product force field. So this works not only for, let's say, simple reactions, like such as the Diels-Alder, but also for more complex transformations, even including transition metals. So we can get, let's say, qualitatively correct structures and also sometimes useful energies. So we can understand this mathematically in terms of this type of model Hamiltonian. So we saw a model Hamiltonian in a talk earlier today. And in the field, this is usually called the empirical valence bond method. So on the diagonal, we have our force field energies, and on the off diagonal, we have some kind of coupling term. And when we work with the C method, we want to make our lives easy, so we simply set this coupling term to zero. So you can wonder if this can be used for something. So we actually employ this in what we call Tartarus. So Tartarus is a benchmark suite for inverse design or generative models. And the purpose of Tartarus is to introduce a bit more realistic design tasks than what is typically done in the community. So in the community, inverse design is usually done with machine learning surrogate models, and here we instead use fast physics-based simulations. So we have a number of different applications, organophotovoltaics, organic emitters, protein ligands, that's based on docking, and then we have this chemical reaction task as well. So how we do this is that we take a reaction, so this is called a double hydrogen atom transfer of syn-sesquinorbornins. So we don't take this reaction because it's very interesting in itself, but because it's very good for a benchmarking task. And the reason why it is very good is that it's very robust, and actually Frank Jensen in his original work compared the results of SIEM versus experiments. We know that it actually has some value. So the workflow is structured like this. So we optimize structures of reactants, products, and transition states using the SIEM method. And then we do full conformational sampling to get robust results. And then from this we can extract activation and reaction energies. So what we then did is to generate a reference data set. So we have over 60,000 reactions which we run through this workflow. We get an extremely high success rate of 99.9%. Unfortunately, we're still a bit limited in terms of the time which this workflow takes. So it takes around 12 minutes per molecule. But this is not limited by the transition state finding or optimization, but by the conformational searches. And this is something that we're currently looking to mitigate. So what we can then do when we have this data set is that we can use it to train generative models, and then we can interface them with the workflow to try to find better molecules. So we did this, and we're looking for molecules which display lower activation energies or lower reaction energies. And we can show that we can actually find some of these. We used a series of different generative models, both genetic algorithm, but also more deep models, such as the variational autoencoders, which Rotheo was also talking about. So I will now move on to the next application. So here we did alchemical optimization with autodifferentiable Hückel theory. So Hückel theory is actually the favorite quantum chemical theory of all organic chemists and also some quantum chemists. And it has a very simple formulation of the Schrödinger equation. So what we can do is to take the molecule and this molecular graph, and then we can build the matrix, which we call the Hückel matrix, where we have atom and bond parameters. And these correspond to different numerical values. Traditionally, you get these from lookup tables. Then we can diagonalize this matrix. We can get orbitals and their energies. We can get things like homolumen gap and so on. And if we code this in an autodifferentiable framework, we can actually backpropagate the error with reference to some higher level of theory, and then we can update the parameters, and we can also do other things. So this is actually quite easy to do nowadays. So I had a NumPy code for Hückel theory. We can just swap out some of the function calls for the corresponding functions in Jax's NumPy module, and then we can get a differentiable code. So we can use this, for example, to optimize the parameter, but we can also do inverse design through so-called alchemical optimization of the atom identities. So what we do is that we take a fixed molecular framework, then we fix some of these atoms as carbon atoms, and then we allow the other atoms to vary, in this case between carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus. And then we can optimize for various properties, for example, homolumen gap, or because we have autodifferentiable theory, it's no problem to do like higher order derivatives, such as the polarizability. And here you can see this inverse design approach in action. So here we're taking the pyrene molecule and we're trying to optimize for a low homolumen gap. And you can see that some of these atoms are being replaced from carbon to, for example, nitrogen and phosphorus. So in the next application, we're also using Hückel theory, but we're interested in another property. So this is called aromaticity. It's a concept from organic chemistry. So we're using something called the Graaff theory of aromaticity. So this is a very old theory from the 1970s. So it was discovered or invented independently in Japan and in Croatia. So it builds on its foundation from Coulson's and Rushbrook's treatment of Hückel theory from a Graaff theoretical standpoint. And basically we exploit the idea that we have the adjacency on the connectivity matrix, and this is very closely related to what we can call the Hückel matrix. And in the Graaff theory of aromaticity, we have a crucial property which we call the olefinic reference system. And this is a system which kind of lacks cyclic conjugation. And then we can calculate various properties as the difference between the real system and the reference system. So how do you do this in practice? So we construct something called a reference polynomial. So if you have the Hückel matrix, we can construct the so-called characteristic polynomial. So this is if you expand the determinant. And then you can, let's say, factor the terms in terms of something called the Sachs subgraphs. So this is also a theory from the 60s. So all the terms of the determinant can be grouped into non-cyclic or cyclic components of these Sachs subgraphs. And to get the reference polynomial, we will basically delete all the terms which have this cyclic nature and then keep the rest. So we will have the, let's say, real characteristic polynomial from the Hückel matrix, then we will have the reference polynomial. We can solve for the roots, and then we get the orbital energies. And we can fill this up with electrons through the Aufbau principle, and then we can get the total energy of the molecule. And based on the energy of these two systems, we can calculate what's called a topological resonance energy, or the TRE. And this is positive for aromatic systems and is negative for anti-aromatic systems. So once we have this in hand, we can actually use it for inverse design. So what we did was to develop a genetic algorithm where we optimize for what we call the percentage TRE, which is a normalized version of the TRE. So in this genetic algorithm, that will be the fitness function. Then we also need genetic operations. And we have, for example, operations for adding rings, removing rings, replacing atoms, and so on. And in this way, we can cover a large chemical space of this type of molecules. So here we have some runs with the genetic algorithm. So we try to maximize aromaticity in the ground state. The genetic algorithm will quickly find benzene as the most aromatic molecule, which kind of makes sense. If we're in the excited state, it will find another molecule. We haven't fully analyzed this yet, but the results are, let's say, quite interesting and maybe surprising. If we go to minimizing the TRE, so kind of finding less aromatic molecules or anti-aromatic molecules, in the ground state, we quickly recover linear acenes. And this is also something which is quite well known, that these are not very aromatic molecules. If you go to the excited state, we again quickly find benzene, and benzene is also known to be the most anti-aromatic molecule in the excited state. So in the last application, I will be talking about screening for OLED materials, and here we're using a pi electron theory, which is called the Parser-Par-Popel theory. So we're interested in OLED materials, and especially in a specific type of OLED materials called Invest. So the special thing about Invest is that we have the singlet S1 state lying below the triplet T1 state. And if you would use this in OLEDs, there's a number of potential advantages. So for example, we could have increased the device lifetimes, increased quantum efficiencies, and so on. On the other hand, there's very, very few molecules which are known which have this property of this inverted gap. So there's an interest of finding more. So if you want to have a theory which can handle this, we cannot use Hückel theory. We need something which can include electron correlation or dynamical electron correlation. That is because this inverted gap is described by something called dynamical spin polarization, or DSP. So it's not even enough if we go to the SAF level and add, let's say, average electron correlation. We actually need to go to the dynamical electron correlation. So we use the PPP method. So this is maybe the simplest method, going from Hückel theory, where you can have the electron-electron correlation. Here's the formulation of the Roten equations, and we want basically to construct the Fock matrix when we solve this. So the nice thing about PPP theory is that it's a semi-empirical method, so we have a number of different parameters, and we can derive these either from experimental data or from different physically motivated formulas. So here we actually borrow a parameterization by Marcus Reyer's PhD supervisor, Jürgen Hintze, from the 1970s. And what we can do in the end is to derive all of these parameters based on valence state ionization potentials and valence state electron affinities, and then just two empirical parameters. So you might be wondering, how good can this method be, given that it's so simple? So we actually did some benchmarkings. This is the QuestDB. So this is a database with like the theoretical best estimates at very high level of theory, excited state coupled cluster and so on. And we can actually see that PPP for the molecules where it is applicable, it's actually quite good, at least in terms of correlation. So that's kind of the average electron correlation. Then we also need the dynamical electron correlation for the excited states. So we have two methods of doing this. So we first need to estimate what is the difference in energy between the singlet and the triplet. And we can estimate this through the exchange integral, so 2 times k. Then we add the correction term for the dynamic spin polarization based on perturbation theory. And this we can get basically from the orbital energies and from the MO electron repulsion integrals. And then we can get an approximate singlet triplet gap by adding these two terms together. We can also be a bit more accurate. So in this case, we do a CIS, or configuration interaction singles calculation. And then we can add these perturbations to these CIS states instead of relying on the orbital picture. So we have the theory, then we need the data set to actually test on the large scale how well this works. So we took a data set designed by my colleague Robert Pollice, where they used design rules to build up a data set from the bottom up. So this contains over 60,000 different compounds, also different substituents, electron withdrawing, electron donating, and so on. So it's quite diverse. And here you can see the results for the different methods. So on the left, we have the SAF approach, the more approximate approach. In the middle, we have the CIS approach. And on the right, we have the CIS approach plus a very simple linear correction. And we evaluate this both on the R squared, which gives, let's say, the absolute correlation, but also the F1 score, where we try to capture, let's say, our capacity to get the molecules which have the inverted gap without getting too many true positives. So we can see that from going from the SAF to the CIS, we improve the R2, so the correlation, but we actually capture less of the molecules that we want to capture. So it turns out that the best of both worlds is to add this linear correlation to get the method which is good in both approaches. And to give you some perspectives, I could run this on the laptop where I'm having currently my presentation in less than 4 hours. And if you want to do this at the reference level of theory, ADC2, which is the excited state coupled cluster method, of course, this will take you enormous many hours on the supercomputer. We could also, because we have this linear correction, we also want to see, can we, let's say, extrapolate? So we have a test set. So here we take a data set from Garner and from Carmen Buff, which was released earlier this year, where they have many compounds which was not in our original data set. And we can see that we can recover the molecules with the inverted gaps in most cases, and we're significantly cheaper than the equation of motion's coupled cluster method that they used for their study. So that, I hope that I've convinced you that, okay, for the inverse design methods, one of the most important parts is actually this property predictor. Machine learning models are maybe not the best approach for doing this if there's other alternatives. And right now we can use fast semi-empirical methods if they are available for our properties. But I think going forward, we're going to see much more of these hybrid methods. And incidentally, semi-empirical methods are actually a very good starting point for building hybrid methods. And finally, if you're interested in, let's say, doing these type of calculations, all the software for doing all the calculations in this presentation are also publicly available on GitHub with permissive licenses, mostly MIT. So with that, I thank you for your attention, and I would be very happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's open for questions.
Okay. Yeah, very nice talk, Xiao.
Thank you.
So my question is, so you show this plot about the iterations of generations.
Sorry, can you repeat?
So you have these curves, which you have the iterations of the different generations, we will find out some nice molecules.
So you're talking about
the first parts, yeah.
This part here?
That's right.
Okay. Good.
So the question is, what is the criteria actually when you do the different generations? So how you stop and how you start again?
Yes, so this was done by a student, and I don't exactly recall what is our starting point, but usually you would start from some kind of data set which is, let's say, representative for the field. Obviously, because it doesn't find benzene immediately, benzene is not in the starting generation. But otherwise, I mean, you could also vary this. You could start with different starting populations, and then this could be, let's say, a hyperparameter of the method as well.
Okay.
So this genetic algorithm, it also, I kind of passed over it, but it also has this, if you look at the plots, it says like explore and exploit. So it will actually use some of the different genetic operations to kind of take larger steps in the chemical space or to exploit closer to where it is. So it actually contains like two populations, one exploitation population and one exploration population. So for example, if you want to do exploration, you might want to do like a crossover where you combine two molecules and get something completely new.
It's a genetic algorithm. I think I missed the list tight.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, no problem.
Thank you, Shell, for the really nice talk. One thing we were discussing with Melissa outside during the break is that there's a general shift towards diffusion models for many of these inverse design methods, especially in the protein design space and places where you have 3D information becoming more important. My question is, do you see the same trend here as well in the applications that you're interested in? Or do you feel that 2D representations is still quite sufficient for many of these applications? What's your perspective on this?
No, I think it depends. So, I mean, the advantage of a diffusion model, I guess, is that you can get a three-dimensional structure as well. So for some applications, it's actually not so difficult for us to get a three-dimensional structure. So for these molecules, I mean, if you would optimize this one, you can do like, you can use RDKit, you get something which is very close to the ground truth, let's say, then you do a force field optimization, then you do a tight binding optimization, and then within less than a second, you have like a good structure for it. So I think in that case, maybe it's not too big an advantage. I think maybe for the transition states, like for the first part of the talk, I mean, if you have something more complex, this can actually start to take a long time to get even at the force field level or at the tight binding level. So I think there's maybe a bit more prospects for diffusion models.
Any further questions?
Sorry. Go ahead. I already asked.
No, you were scratching your head.
Okay. Yeah, I had one more question related to when you were talking about the aromatic compounds. There was a recent work from Renana's group on the Gaudi model, and I was curious if you had a chance to benchmark it. I mean, they're also quite recent, so maybe not, but maybe if you could comment on how the methods compare.
Yeah, so I know Renana's work very well, and I think it's very nice. So you might see also that I said that this is unpublished. So it's also a project which we have not had the time to finish. So I think, I mean, it would obviously be quite nice to benchmark it to Renana's as well. I think, I mean, Renana's work also is a generative model which is trained on a lot of DFT data. So now we have that data and we can train those models. But before that, you will not be able to do that kind of work. So actually what the first step they needed to do was to generate a large database of like polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. I think the advantage with a genetic algorithm and something like this is that it's kind of non-empirical. So it's like, okay, you have a good fitness function, you have a good starting point, you have genetic operations, then you're kind of good to go. You don't need to have a PhD student spending a few years to gather that data set. So. Thanks.
Okay, any
chance? Another question? Okay, up there.
Do you see, you know, a renaissance of semi-empirical methods coming soon?
I think it's already here.